All right. Hi, everyone. Can you hear this? Yeah. Great. So my name is Aki. I'm very happy to be here today. Here's my Twitter handle. I work at Valo Research and Trading as a senior quantitative analyst and software engineer. My talk today is about opinionated Scala. But I'd like to start by asking you, how many of you have used Scala? Please raise your hand if you have done any programming in Scala. Okay, so quite a few of you have at least tried Scala. So the talk is about opinionated Scala. I will talk about Scala styles and some pitfalls related to Scala and how we are using Scala at Valo Research and Trading. Scala is often seen and marketed as a transition language. Scala can be seen as a better Java. And it's easy to see why this is, because Scala runs on top of the JVM. It has very good Java interoperability, and you can basically write very Java-ish code in Scala. So Scala can make the Java developers' eyes shine. That finally I get rid of all these annoyances in Java. Finally, I get closures. I get kind of more concise syntax for doing the same things that I have done for a long time. And there even exists a feature in the IntelliJ IDEA Scala plugin. You can copy Java code to a clipboard, try to paste it into a Scala file, and it will ask you, would you like to convert this to Scala code? Please don't show this dialogue next time. I think viewing Scala only as a better Java can be a very slippery slope. So I like to challenge Scala as a better Java because there are a lot of ways of writing Scala. And by mixing all these styles, you can create very confusing Scala. And only seeing kind of the one style, which would be a better Java, I think that can be dangerous when dealing with Scala. So Scala adds a lot of features to Java. It adds a lot of concepts, a lot of abstractions, and while doing so, Scala also removes a lot of restrictions from the Java language. Java is a very restrictive language, and Scala is not. So the assumptions you're used to doing when you're reasoning about Java programs, they may no longer hold with Scala. So I think using Scala requires discipline, it requires change in your thought process, and it requires you to change your habits. And I think if you remember one thing from this presentation, it should be this. Everyone using Scala should be opinionated. There are multiple ways, be aware of them, and try to pick kind of one style, and try to stick to that one style when writing Scala. Try to make one of the styles your own. So here's the outline of my presentation. I will start by explaining what we do at Valo Research and Trading, how we are using Scala for that, or why we are using Scala for that. And then I'm going to continue and describe what I think is important for good programs. And then we're going to go through some of the pitfalls of Scala related to about how we're making good programs. And then I'm going to describe our Scala style, what kind of Scala we are trying to write at Valo. And hopefully we will have some time for questions in the end. So let's start with Valo Research and Trading. Valo is a subsidiary of Reaktor. We are doing automated trading in the financial markets. And opposed to the rest of the business of Reaktor, we are not doing consulting, but we are doing product development. We are doing what's called proprietary trading. That means we are trading using the company's own funds. And to do this, we need to do two things. We need to do research, and we need to do trading. And research means that we need to study and understand the effects that affect the financial markets. We need to move fast. We need to try different things. And because research is all about trying different things and seeing what could work. So we need to experiment a lot. We also need to process very large data sets, because the financial data sets can be easily in the range of terabytes. So we need to process large data sets. And we also need to be able to verify that our results that we're getting are correct, because often it's not very clear what the right answer would be. So we need to be sure that what we're computing is actually correct. And based on this research, we are also doing trading. So we are taking these automated strategies and executing them in the financial markets. And we are doing what's called fast automated intraday trading. So we're basically constantly ready to buy and sell. We're constantly, trades are occurring more or less all the time. So instead of balancing the portfolio like once a day or once a week, we are constantly trading. And to do this, we need to also be able to move fast by means of being productive and adaptive, because the markets are changing. We need to take things from our research, take them into production, but we also need to have low latencies. So we are interested about speed, and we are very interested about reliability. And to do this, we need to have a really good understanding of how our systems work. So we need to have understanding of all the components in the system, and we need to be able to reason about our systems. So why are we using Scala for this? We are using a high-level language, such as Scala, because we want to be productive. We want to be able to adapt quickly. That's the reason for using a high-level language. We could use, or other high-level languages provide this as well. As Brian said, Haskell is also a very good high-level language. But we are using Scala because we have very good understanding of the JVM, which for us means that we are more confident, for example, in terms of speed optimizations. You can create fast code in Haskell, but we are more confident in doing this with the JVM. And for the JVM, we also have very good tooling available. So all the performance profiling tools and things like that, they're also available for Scala. So we have good tools available. And one plus in Scala for us is also the Java interoperability. So we need to do integrations to multiple places. So sometimes we have to use, for example, proprietary Java libraries to do that. And Scala allows us to do these kinds of integrations easily. So these are some of the reasons why we are using Scala. You might be wondering about the speed of Scala. So some guys are doing trading using pure hardware solutions, such as FPGAs. It's sometimes called ultra-high frequency trading. We have some limits where we can go with the JVM. So we are not trying to compete with pure speed, because the hardware will always beat the JVM. But we are still trying to do things pretty quickly. So, and we can be pretty fast. So in terms of latencies, we're still talking about milliseconds and even sub-milliseconds. All right, so let's move to good programs. What I think is most important for building good programs. So what are we trying to accomplish with all this? What are we trying to accomplish by using a high-level language such as Scala? What should it bring to the table to be useful? I think programming is about abstraction. Good programs are about abstractions. And abstraction is about hiding the unnecessary details while keeping the essential visible. You want to hide the complexities behind good abstractions. This is also what Brian was talking about in the keynote. You want to build abstractions which hide the complexities. And finding and creating good abstractions, that's a hard thing to do. That's especially hard when you need to make your programs understandable for other human beings. So Donald Knuth has said that programming is the art of telling another human being what one wants the computer to do. And I think this is a great quote, because it says that telling the computer what you want the computer to do, that's the easy part. The hardest part is telling another human being what you want the computer to do. This is sometimes called the clarity of intent. You want your intent to be clear from the code you are writing. You want to make your programs as easy to reason about as possible. So seen from this viewpoint, programming can be seen as the art of simplifying. You're trying to simplify the complex details of your domain. You're trying to build abstractions which hide all the crap so that you can make them understandable. And so you're finding abstractions which simplify. the domain you're working with. And when you view your goal as trying to make programs which are easy to reason about, I think Scala can sometimes be problematic. And this leads us to the pitfalls of Scala. As you may know, Scala is a multi-paradigm language. It supports imperative, object-oriented, and functional programming. If you're like me, you're mostly used to doing imperative and object-oriented programming, either in Java or in some other languages. So that's what you're familiar with, at least I am. Scala allows you to mix all these three into one. So Haskell is a purely functional language. You're starting from purely functional code. You're writing functional code in Haskell. Scala allows you to mix all these three together in any way you see fit. And Scala has a lot of features to support all these three. So we can compare, for example, the imperative and functional features in Scala. Scala has the while keyword. You can do while loops as you would in Java. You can do the same in Scala. But Scala also has the functional counterpart of while loops, which is tail recursion and tail call optimization. Scala has the var keyword, which is for mutable variables, variables whose value change over time. But Scala also has the functional counterpart, which is vals and lazy vals, values whose value don't change over time, so they're not variables. And Scala has the return keyword, but you almost never have to use the return keyword with Scala, because in Scala, everything is also an expression. Whatever you write, it's an expression which automatically returns the value of this expression. So you almost never have to use the return keyword with Scala. And Scala has the for keyword. You can use it in an imperative way to construct for loops. So you can loop over a numeric range, as you would in Java. But the for keyword in Scala is also a more powerful concept. It's called for comprehension. So kind of that's the functional counterpart of for loops. And Scala provides all of these functional features and all of these imperative features. And the same goes with the object-oriented way of reasoning about programs. You can write classes and methods in Scala, just like you would in Java. But Scala also allows you, it gives you an easy syntax to write abstract data types and functions. So instead of writing classes which have methods, you can write abstract data types which are like classes but only containing immutable data without any methods. So abstract data types are just kind of data classes. You can write abstract data types and functions which modify or transform these immutable abstract data types into new immutable abstract data types. That's what you do when you're programming in Haskell. Scala allows you to do that. Abstract data types in Scala are, you can use case classes to do that. In object-oriented languages, you can do what's called extension methods. That means adding functionality to existing classes without modifying the original class. You can do this in Scala using implicit conversions. But Scala also has the functional counterpart of kind of the same feature, which is called type classes. You can use implicit parameters in Scala to implement type classes. Type classes are things that add functionality to existing types without modifying the original type. And in addition to supporting all of these paradigms, Scala also has a lot of syntactic features. Scala has symbolic function names, which can be used to do operator overloading. You can name your functions as you want, and you can name them operators. Scala often lets you omit the dots, semicolons, parentheses, and curly braces. You can choose whether to use them or not. Scala has infix function calls. You can say 1 max 2, which basically is the maximum of 1 and 2. This can be implemented using the omission of dots and implicit conversions. Scala also has many uses for the underscores character. As you know, if you have tried to learn Scala, there are a lot of ways you can use the underscore character in Scala. And in addition to these features, Scala also has some JVM limitations. So because Scala runs on top of the JVM, it wants to kind of keep the Java interoperability, you have some limitations. You still have the null in Scala. In Scala, you can write code which pretty effectively kind of eliminates the possibility of nulls in your code, but nothing on the JVM level, nothing prevents you from nulling objects, because that's how the JVM works. The type erasure still bites you in the ass from time to time. Scala does its best to avoid type erasure. There are all kind of tricks, or should I say hacks, to avoid type erasure, but sometimes you still can't get around it. And Scala has problems with the tail call optimizations in some situations because of the limitations of the JVM again. But the kind of the problem with this is that Scala has all these features. It allows you to mix all this into one program, but Scala as a language doesn't provide you any guidelines how to do this. So you can choose to mix this all in any way you want. And when your target is to simplify, I think this can be problematic. You easily create programs which are no longer easy to reason about, because you can make no assumptions about how the code works. You don't know whether there are side effects, whether there is what kind of assumptions you can make about the code. And if you compare this to what you're used to doing with Java, with Java you're used to defining the code syntax formatting rules. You're used to defining where to put the parentheses and whether to use tabs or spaces. You need to do that with Scala as well. But in addition to defining the syntax formatting rules, I think you also need to define kind of principles and values with Scala. What kind of Scala you're writing? So kind of defining your style. Someone has said that every software house which has successfully used C++ have basically invented their own language by choosing the subset of features they're using. I'm not saying Scala is C++. I don't like C++, I do like Scala. But there is a bit of that. You kind of need to define the principles and values, how to use Scala, or there is a risk of creating confusing code. And this leads us to our Scala style. What kind of Scala are we writing, kind of trying to define our principles and values of the code? Our first value when writing Scala is to take functional programming and immutability very seriously. This is because I think functional programs can be easier to reason about. When you have pure referentially transparent functions which take an input and always return the same output without creating any side effects or being dependent on any external state, you can make your functions easier to reason about. Constructing programs in this fashion, I think it makes them cleaner. So restricting side effects, it can also, because it makes the program easy to reason about, it can reduce the amount of bugs that there are in the code, and it can also make the code more testable. And because this is sometimes a very hard thing to do, especially if you're coming from an object-oriented background. I have used a lot of Java, a lot of C++. I'm kind of, my brains are thinking in an object-oriented way. So one very useful guideline for us has been to consider Haskell. Haskell is a lot more restrictive functional programming environment. I'm hoping this word Haskellify will end up in some kind of programmer dictionary one day. So kind of considering how we would go and solve some given problem in Haskell can lead you into thinking more functionally. We're not using Haskell because, as I said, we are more comfortable in using the JVM what we are doing, but just considering how we would go and solve a problem in Haskell, that has been a useful guideline for us to kind of understand what would be the functional approach. Scala Scala allows you to write the familiar object-oriented imperative solution because you have both of these tools at your disposal. But yeah, this has been a very good, useful guideline for us. So what kind of constructs we are favoring in Scala? We are favoring tail recursion over while loops, because if you're doing a while loop, you have to have mutable state. The while loop is not going to do anything on its own. We are trying to use lazy vals and vals over mutable variables. We're also using expressions over returns. When writing functional Scala, we have zero returns in our functional Scala in the code base. I just checked. We're also using abstract data types and functions over classes and methods. So we're using case classes and functions which transform these case classes into new case classes. Another value for us, we are trying to prefer maximum readability and simplicity. And what this means in the context of Scala, it means that we are not always using the most concise form of Scala that's available. Scala allows you to write a lot of things in very, very concise form. But if we think that something is more readable when it's a little bit more verbose, we are using the little bit more verbose form. We're also trying to avoid any kind of clever trickery. Cleverness is the enemy of simplicity. We're trying to prefer simplicity. There is a library called ScalaZ. ScalaZ tries to implement all the things from Haskell in Scala, all the functional concepts. And there, I think at some point they are going from simplicity and building useful abstractions to the point where it's just kind of clever trickery, because Scala doesn't allow you to build all these concepts clearly because of the limitations. So Scala, as a functional programming language, has some limitations because it also has to support object-oriented programming, the imperative programming, and it runs on top of the JVM, so it cannot do all the things that, for example, the Haskell compiler is doing. And this is kind of, that's why we are trying to kind of have simplicity as our value. If something starts to look like clever trickery, then we are just not doing that. All right, let's show some examples of this. What kind of decisions have we made in our code to kind of try to respect these values? The first one is that we are not using symbolic names, in other words, operator overloading, for the most part. I think operator overloading can be a useful concept when there is a pre-existing known meaning for the operators. So basically, two of the things where this is true, it's mathematics and theoretical computer science. Because mathematics is often defined, the mathematics language is defined using operators. So it's very natural to do the same thing in the code. So linear algebra, parser combinators, or the example that's always used with operator overloading, complex numbers, they are great use for operator overloading. But there are also bad examples. The dispatch HTTP client library. The standard Scala library for doing HTTP requests. These are all the operators that you can and should use to create HTTP requests. Call me old-fashioned, but what the fuck? I'm used to doing HTTP requests, but I have no idea what these operators mean. So dispatch has tried to invent an operator syntax for doing HTTP requests. While doing so, they have created some elegant concepts in the library. But I think these operators are just not useful. So another example is the Scala build tool, SBT. I think SBT has also gone a little bit overboard with the operators. I think they are doing something to reduce the operators now, which I think is a good thing. You can go overboard with the operator overloading when you're using Scala. So our rule of thumb is to avoid operator overloading unless we're dealing with mathematics or sometimes with theoretical computer science. Another controversial feature of Scala are the implicits. This is a tweet from a few days ago. Deej said, debugging Scala implicits is like trying to find the farter in a crowded room. I couldn't have said it better myself. So implicits can cause trouble with Scala. But there are good uses for the implicits as well. They're not only a beast. So good uses for implicit conversions. I think there are good uses in ACA actor library. You can define your timeouts like this, 3 seconds or 100 milliseconds. That's a useful use of implicit conversions because you have to do that quite often when you're using ACA. So it's a clean syntax for defining timeouts. You don't have to wonder whether these were milliseconds or what. Another good use can be from the Scala standard library, the definition of ranges. You can say 1 until 10, which defines a range from 1 to 10. That's also something that you use pretty often when you're using Scala defining ranges. So it's a good use of implicit conversions. The Scala test framework is also another good example. Using Scala test, you can define your tests in a very readable format because it utilizes implicit conversions. Then another implicit thing in Scala is implicit parameters. And the good use of these implicit parameters, I think the type classes that can be found from the Scala standard library, these are good use of implicit parameters. So type classes, they are a construct that you can use to add new features to existing types without modifying the existing type. So one example is the ordering. You can add ordering by defining an ordering type class for the type without modifying your original class. So here's a very simple example. I have a case class test, and as you see, there is no implicit ordering for this without defining it. We don't know how to sort these tests. But we can define a test ordering using the ordering type class from the Scala standard library. So we define an implicit instance of ordering with the type text. And by this, we add that, okay, we are sorting it by the integer I. And after this, we can use the Scala standard library functions, which utilize this ordering type class. We can create a list of tests, which is not ordered, and just say test.sorted, and we get an ordered list of the tests. That's a good use of implicit parameters. But the bad part is that always when you're adding implicits, each implicit makes you think harder when you're reading the code. We want our code to be simple. We want our code to be easy to reason about. So our rule of thumb is to avoid using implicits in our application code. I think implicits can be useful in certain generic libraries. I could consider using type classes in our code, but they're a pretty dangerous weapon when used in the application code. So our rule of thumb is to avoid them as much as we can. If we can find other ways of doing the same thing, we're trying to prefer that. All right. So let's show some examples from our code base. So we are doing automated trading. That means we are creating agents, strategies, whatever you want to call them, which receive signals from the real world and need to do or want to do some kind of actions based on these signals. So this is an example of the Haskellify principle. We arrived at this design by considering what we would do in Haskell. It's also about using abstract data types and functions over classes and methods, and about not having side effects. So we have an agent trait, which has two functions. First one is called initial state, which returns the abstract data type state. And another is the actions, which takes the current state and an event that has occurred, returns a new immutable state and a list of actions. This is pretty much the same thing that Brian was talking about state transformations. We are doing state transformations. We have a step function, actions, which takes in the current state and transforms it into the next state that we want to be in. And while doing so, we also generate some kind of actions that the agent wants to create. So we are using abstract data types for this. I'm using a very simple, optimistic Finnish Nokia agent as an example. So this agent's goal is to buy more Nokia and hope it will go up. Its state consists only of the holdings of its current Nokia shares. It has n holdings number of shares at any point in time. And as you see, this is a case class, so it's immutable. And we define our agent as an object, first of all, so these are functions, not methods. We are not creating an instance of the Nokia agent. We are only using it as a singleton. So there is no shared state within the object. And we are extending the agent trait with the type parameter Nokia agent state. And the initial state, it generates the initial state, which is to have zero holdings of Nokia. And the action function is defined as a pattern match. We also use a lot of pattern matching. I think pattern matching is a great feature of Scala, and it can lead to very, very clear code. So we are pattern matching the incoming event. In this case, we are only interested about news events. So we're assuming we are receiving some kind of machine-readable news events for the agent. And we're checking if it's related to Nokia. If this news event is a news event which is related to Nokia, then we are going to react. And we are going to do two things. We need to update the state, so create a new instance of the state, and return a list of actions that we want to get executed. So the update state updates the state by adding 100 shares, and the action is defined as a portfolio transformation. So we construct the target portfolio, how many Nokia shares the agent wants to have. It constructs the target portfolio. And then we create a portfolio transformation and move the responsibility of transforming our portfolio to this target amount away from the agent, so we have another part of our system which handles these transformations, and it will make sure that we get the 100 more Nokias into our portfolio. And this means this whole agent is purely referentially transparent. For the same input, it will always do the same thing. And by doing this, we can make the agent pretty easy to reason about. We can write agent functions that we understand, which means that they are easier to test, we can understand them better, which leads to less bugs. And this has been a good design decision, in my opinion. Another thing that we are doing in our code, we are creating simple DSLs with limited scope. And with DSLs, I think the limited scope is always important. Creating DSLs which are used everywhere, it's a hard job to do correctly. But creating DSLs for some certain specific problems, that can be very useful, because it can, again, hide the complexities and bring the essential to the front. So it can make your programs easier to understand or easier to reason about. And we are not using, for the most part, symbolic function names and no implicits. So in this example, there are no implicits and no operators. So this is one of the DSLs we are using. It's for filtering news, filtering machine-readable news. And I think this is pretty readable. It says company is from the US, company belongs to the Dow Jones Industrial Average Index, news has something to do with dividends, and it has occurred between 12:10 and 1:30 in the EST time zone. So these kind of DSLs make it easier to see what's essential for this part of the code. We're often very interested what kind of news is interesting to this agent, this piece of code. This makes it very easy to see what it is. So this is the way we are designing these principles. We are again trying to value simplicity. So we're not using, we could have used operators for this. We could have taken something like set theory and defined operators based on that and used that for our DSL. I just think this is more readable. Yeah. So about the speed. For the most part, functional way of writing Scala is fast enough. You can write most of your stuff as you want in Scala. But as Brian said in his keynote, that that you sometimes have to compromise with abstractions and kind of using less abstractions for gaining speed in Python. And that's also true true with Scala. You sometimes have to kind of give up some of the abstractions in order to gain speed where you need it the most. So our strategy for gaining speed is to start with the pure gold, which is functional programming. We're starting with functional programming. And when we have profiling results that we know that some part has to be very fast and it cannot be implemented quickly with the functional constructs in Scala. So in that case, we are just moving to doing very simple procedural Scala. So we are trying to be at the either end. We are either trying to write very clear, pure functional Scala, or if we know that some part requires a lot of speed, then we are just moving to the immutable kind of mode. We are trying to do it very clearly. Sometimes we are even using vanilla Java as kind of our assembler to write some classes in pure Java, because then we can get exact control over the bytecode that gets generated. With Scala, you cannot always be, kind of the bytecode sometimes surprises you what Scala generates. So using Java, we have full control. And one example where we are doing this is the parsing of binary messages. This is from one of our open source projects called Stirling. This is the message parsing for a binary protocol called ICH. And because this gets called millions and millions of times, we needed to optimize this function, which means we are using mutable byte buffers. This looks pretty much what you would do in Java in a very simple way, something you would do in C almost. So we're trying to, when we are moving to the imperative mode and trying to gain the speed, we are trying to avoid any kind of Java tricks. We are not creating object hierarchies. We are just writing very simple procedural code where we get control over all the loops that gets done. And the reason we are doing this, because I think it can be confusing to mix the imperative and functional code in the code base without kind of clearly defining the boundaries. We are trying to put these kind of imperative procedural codes into some kind of boxes where we read the code. We know that we need to reason about this in an imperative way. And for the other parts of the code, we can reason about it in a functional way. So we're trying to separate these two and be clear about what we are doing. We are sometimes even calling these classes with a mutable prefix to kind of mock them. All right. So the summary. I like Scala as a language. Scala brings a lot of useful tool for abstraction. And I think you can write elegant functional code in Scala. That's what I like about in Scala. But Scala can also kind of be seen as a chainsaw. I like to call using Java as manually sawing wood. You don't want to manually saw wood these days because you have chainsaws. But if you take the chainsaw and just start sawing without changing your habits, without changing your thought process, without changing your practices, or generally not thinking what you're doing, things are not going to look pretty. And I don't think you should fool yourself by thinking that Scala is a better Java, because it's a lot more, and there are a lot of tools that you can get used to. So our style of writing Scala is to use functional programming while keeping it simple. And so the main point that you should remember from this presentation is that everyone using Scala should be opinionated. Everyone doesn't use Scala, doesn't have to use Scala the same way that we do, but I think everyone should have an opinion what kind of Scala they are writing. So I think you need to define your style and try to stick to that one particular style. Yeah. So I have written about a few of these things in my blog. You can go and check that out as well. We have some of our projects available in GitHub, and valotrading.com is our website. And if you want to, I think we have some time for questions now, and you can also, I'll be here all day, so you can just come and ask me after this session as well. Thank you.